All right. So we are on time, and good afternoon everyone, and thank you for joining for today's talk. It is a kind of topic that we are all very familiar with, but it's a very difficult topic to define. We'll come to know about it. The moment I sent this topic to our communication team, Chetna is sitting here, she called me back saying this topic appears to be very convoluted, and I said it is supposed to be convoluted. In fact, the current convolutional neural networks that we have in AI are not able to manage the concept of causality. So we'll through this one hour 15 minutes talk, we'll try and understand some bits of causal reasoning, and we'll see what are the things that intrigues people from ancient ages till today. And we'll try and find out some questions as well as some answers of this topic. So let me move to the front slide, and here is a picture. I know everybody must be aware of this picture, they must have seen it. Let me tell you the story. The first human pair, Adam and Eve, were placed by the God in a garden which was called Garden of Eden. I know everyone is aware of Eden Garden of Kolkata, right? So Adam and Eve were basically naked and innocent at that time, and God forbade them to eat from this tree which is visible in the diagram. So when God came after some time, he saw Adam hiding. He realized something is fishy, and he asked Adam, what did you do? And Adam replied that the woman that you gave me for companionship, she gave me a fruit of the tree and I ate it. God went to Eve and said, Eve, what did you do? And Eve said that the serpent deceived me into eating this fruit, saying that if I eat this fruit, I will be like God. So of course, this didn't work very well with God, and they were banished from the from this beautiful Garden of Eden or Eden Garden. But if you see this conversation carefully, you would realize that God asked what? Question was, what did you do? And the reply was, why? Both of them replied why they ate the fruit from the tree, assuming that if I give an explanation, it will somehow legitimize my action, right? This is what we do in the classroom. If I say, were you late for the class, people will say, oh, it was raining outside. So I didn't ask for a reason, but reasoning comes so naturally to human beings. And therefore, this caption, this I think, therefore I am, it was given by a famous French philosopher, Descartes, who said that there must be a thinking entity, including, I mean, in this case, ourself, for there to be a thought. So if there has to be a thought, there has to be a thinking entity, and therefore human beings are naturally designed for this particular attribute. Now I'll take you through a very important what we call as a cause-effect relationship, and this particular concept was given by a very famous computer scientist by the name of Julia Pearl. So he defined three levels of causation, okay, which we not normally call as cause-effect relationship. So he said there are three levels, level 1, level 2 and level 3. Level 1 is basically about seeing, level 2 is about doing, and level 3 is about imagining, retrospection. I explain to you this in detail. But let me also add, before I go into this detail, that human beings, if you see or if you read the evolutionary process, you would realize that very, very early in the evolution of Homo sapiens, they realize that there is something which is very different with the Homo sapiens, that is us, which can propel us to this world, into the major species, right? And that is imagination, which I'll talk about in detail. So if you go to the first level, which is the seeing, okay, many of these species on the face of the earth also share this attribute. They are able to, they are able to observe. So, a cat is able to see that, you know, the rat will probably move from this place to this place, and therefore, I should actually move in this direction to be able to eat that as a prey. So, this seeing in artificial intelligence or machine learning or mathematics or statistics is actually called as association, or is modeled using what is called as conditional probability. Okay. So, this is simply observation. Seeing is primarily observation. Okay. So, this entails, so when I am talking about the word seeing, it entails you know, observing regularities in the patterns. So, it is basically finding some patterns in the data, which is what seeing talks about. When I am talking about the second rung of the ladder, which is intervention, and this is something which is extremely important for all of us to understand as to how this works. I will give you an example. Okay. So, in this case intervention, we are saying there is something which we are doing here, and this is deliberate. When you use the word intervention, it basically means deliberate. Okay. So, take an example. Suppose I am CEO of a company, I am the marketing head of a company, let us assume. I go to my organization and I ask my manager, what is the pattern of sales with respect to toothbrush and toothpaste? Or say, if I refine my question, I say, how many people are buying how many people who are buying toothpaste are also buying toothbrush? Okay. If this is my question, what will my manager do? He will go to the data which is available, the sales data. For example, let us say Big Bazaar, I go back to, let us say, last 5 years of data and mine the data and find out all those people who have bought a toothpaste. And from that sample, from that list, I will find out all those people who have also bought a toothbrush. And then using simple fraction computation, I can find out how many people are also buying toothbrush who are buying toothpaste. So, that answer I can easily give. Now, suppose I modify the question little bit and I say that what if I double the price of toothpaste, now tell me how many people will buy toothbrush. Can you tell me how will I answer this question? How will I answer this question? I am saying I will double the price of toothpaste, what is going to happen with the sales of toothbrush? Can you go back to the data and answer this question using the data? Okay. How? Just give you an example. Okay, I can hear. Go ahead. Okay, so I am not asking for a specific case, I am asking for a pattern. I am saying what is going to happen to the sales of toothbrush if I double the price of toothpaste. Now, some people will say, as you rightly said, let us say that I can go back in the data and find out something, right? I can go back in the data and say there were times when the price of toothpaste doubled, and I can check what happened to the sales of toothbrush in those instances, and I can answer the question using that data point, right. But the question is slightly different. Question is, if I go back to the history and take out some pattern from there and answer your question, it does not really answer my question which I am asking. I am asking, because you might say, for example, in the month of, let us say, April, COVID happened, the prices of medicine doubled, even then the sales went up. Right, because it went up everywhere. So, as a customer, I had no choice. Right. So, despite the fact that prices went up, the sales also went up. Right. So, the data is not showing what I want. What I am saying is, irrespective of market conditions, I do not care about what is the competitor doing. All I am saying is, I am going to change the price of toothpaste. Tell me what will happen to the price of toothbrush, irrespective of anything else which is happening in the environment. It is a question which I am asking, that I want to do a deliberate intervention, okay, and then I want to answer this question, what is going to happen with respect to sales of toothbrush. It is different than what you are answering. And this is what human beings understand, Homo sapiens understand, that they can modify their settings. They can change their settings to modify something else. And that is what propelled us so fast in this evolutionary process, and we conquered the world through such kind of things. Okay, so this is one intervention. I hope you understand the meaning of the word intervention. Now let me bring your attention to the third part of it, which is the counterfactuals. Okay, and you can see, I don't want to get into the detail, but you can see that the answer of the intervention cannot be done only using this simple conditional probability. So I now bring your attention to the counterfactuals, and the word says counterfactuals. It means it is counter to the fact. So you just saw an example where I can't necessarily answer the question using the existing data. Now let's come to the counterfactuals. Now counterfactuals have terrible relationship with data, existing data. Okay. Now what happens is, in this case, in the world of counterfactuals, I am asking an alternate scenario. Suppose I ask you, what would have happened if we would not have locked down the country in the month of March 2020? Now, how would you answer this question? Okay, now this question requires that you go back in time, change your decision, and let the world suffer with a new decision, and then I will compare the two. So this goes against what is available fact. That's why it's called as counterfactuals. And no data can provide answer to this question. Okay. So counterfactuals are very, very interesting scenario. And this, in simple term, I have written a simple term here, which is imagination. And this is a unique characteristics of humans. We really don't know whether rats can imagine, but humans can imagine. And with this imagination, we have created so many things, like, you know, communities are imaginations, right? Companies are imaginations. There's a lot of thing which is imagination, and human beings have done it tremendously in the last many, many years, which has propelled us to what we are today, right? So this is counterfactuals, and it just gives you an example that there are many instances wherein you would not be able to answer question from the existing data. Right? Can I say I took a medicine and I was cured of COVID? Now I ask, was the medicine which cured me? Now can I go back in time and change myself and not take the medicine, take something else and see if I would have cured myself? Right? So this is what we are talking about in the world of counterfactuals, and you would find books on counterfactuals and many books, not only one. Just on the word of counterfactual, you will find many, many researches which have been done. So I'll take you a little bit more deeper into it with some more examples. Okay. So if you look at the current state-of-the-art machine learning programs, what are they able to achieve? You know, machine learning is basically, as of now, highly advanced. It is actually solving a lot of problems which we were not able to solve earlier. But in this ladder of causation, the current machine learning is at step one. The current machine learning programs are able to do only this much. They are able to throw interesting patterns to you, but not able to answer these two questions. And that's why, despite the fact that we have, you know, even the deep neural networks, which have added so many complex layers between the input and output, they're also not capable to answer questions which I am talking about in the world of counterfactuals, right? So let's move to the next one. So here is an interesting example. You know, you must have heard about a very famous computer scientist by the name of Alan Turing. Okay, there is a Turing Award in computer science, which is considered as a Nobel Prize. Okay, so and there is a name of movie by the same name, Imitation Game. You may have seen that movie. If you have not, go and watch that. I am recommending you to watch this movie. Okay. So Turing, Alan Turing in 1950 was basically working on this game, which is called as Imitation Game. Now, normally computer scientists call this as a Turing test. Okay. The term that we is called as Turing test in computer parlance. Now, what Turing was basically saying that in the next 50 years, in fact, let me first define what was he, you know, what was he thinking when he said that in next 50, 60 years, human beings will be able to create a thinking machine. So, it is important for us to understand what do you mean when you say thinking machine. This said, he said that a computer would be called thinking machine if an ordinary human communicating with a computer by a typewriter could not tell whether he was talking with human or computer. That was his definition. That means, if I am interacting with somebody and there is a wall in between, I do not know who is on the other side, I should not be able to distinguish whether it is a computer or a human being with whom I am interacting. Right. Now, so there is a competition which happens every year. It has changed the format, but it is called as Lebner Prize competition. It says that, you know, we will take chatbots, okay, and we'll have judges who will basically interact with the chatbot, and any chatbot which is able to fool the judges into thinking that it is a human will basically earn. Okay. Now, and the prize is quite a heavy prize, I mean that is available in this case, but unfortunately in the last many years, we have not been able to defeat even two of the four judges in this game where the entire world works to create such a chatbot. Okay. So, you can understand where are we with respect to our output in AI. Now, although this whole competition has now changed, now there are no more four judges, the entire world can actually judge this. So, go take a look, and if you want to participate, you can also participate in this competition. It is open, right. So, we can understand that the thinking machine is still elusive, despite the fact that Turing in 1950 made this claim that, you know, in the next 50-60 years, human beings will be able to create a thinking machine. Let me add that it is the effort of Turing that AI has progressed so much. So, you know, there is an Alan Turing Institute, and if you are aware of it, it does tremendous research in the area of AI. And thanks to Turing, I think the world has progressed too far in the area of AI, and we need to cover a long distance even now. Okay. So, I will come back to this term called correlation and causation, which is the topic that we wanted to understand. Let me also add that all the statisticians always chant this mantra that correlation is not causation. Okay. It's something that they all know. Okay. But let me go back and review what is a correlation. I would not say it is a proper definition of causation, but it is a working definition, let us say. Okay. So, correlation is basically saying that if there is a relationship or a pattern between the values of two variables, you know, and then we will have a correlation. It can be positive correlation, it can be negative correlation. Positive means they both go up together, and negative means that they are opposite in terms of directions. And how do we find this correlation? We can do a simple scatter plot, and it will be able to show you the correlation. Causation is basically about finding the cause, and is there a relationship between the two? There is some relationship, although it is quite a challenge to answer what exactly is the relationship. For example, you know, a nursery teacher finds out that there is a high correlation between larger shoe size and, let us say, the grade in the class. Okay. So, she observes that larger the shoe, better is the grade. That is a correlation between the data points. Now, what do we infer from this correlation? That means, if I need my child to score high in nursery, should I start sending her or him with a larger shoe? So there has to be, or in this case, there might be some other reason which might be leading to it. Okay. So here is an example, another example, that Mr. X found that when ice cream sales are low, air conditioner sales also tend to be low, and that when ice cream sales are high, air conditioner sales are also high. So, you see that there is a positive correlation between the ice cream sales and the sale of air conditioner. So, should we start more ice creams if you have to sell more air conditioner, or should we, if you want to control air pollution and you assume that ACs might be contributing to it, take care of the ice cream sales, right? So, should we do that? So, this is what we are saying. He can conclude that the sales of ice cream cones and those of air conditioners are positive. This is what data is showing to you. Okay, this is what data is showing to you. But the problem is, actually, this is not the right conclusion, and we know from our experience. How do we teach a machine that this is not correct? That's the challenge. Okay, because as a human being, we have understood, reasoning comes so naturally to us. Okay, it is very natural for us to think in this way. So, causal reasoning is actually very natural to human beings, but extremely difficult for a computer to understand. We haven't found the right way, forget about understanding, even to represent such a knowledge. Okay, so, representation of causal reasoning is also a very big challenge in the area of artificial intelligence, and there are conferences which happens only on this topic, representation of causal information. Okay. So, all right, so take another example. Okay, we use the term spurious correlation. I will leave this presentation for a second. I need to drink some water. So, we define this term called spurious correlation. You can see the graph, it shows a relationship between two things. Okay, number of people who died by becoming in their bed sheet and the cost of banana. Now, so first of all, it's hard to believe how people will die with tangling of bed sheets, but let's assume anything can happen in our world, our real world. So there is a correlation, and the correlation is quite high, it's 0.8. So all those people who do simple mathematics will agree that there is very strong correlation between the cost of banana and the number of people who die by becoming tangled in the bed sheet. So that means that I need to add a functionality in my Apple Watch, okay, which will track the cost of banana on the world and say, now the cost has gone over the roof, get up and disentangle your bed sheet, otherwise you will die, right? So this is spurious correlation. Again, as a human being, we are able to understand from our experience. For a machine, how do machines automatically know that this correlation is spurious? The value is fairly high. And if you look at research papers coming in this area, you would find so many of them with such wrong correlations, and people keep publishing left, right, center with such data. Okay. All right. So I'll come back. Same question, cause effect relationship, and this is very hard problem, by the way. Okay. Causation, understanding causation is a very difficult problem. Okay. The Carl Pearson, those of you who have done some bit of statistics, is basically called as father of statistics, right? Carl Pearson was a disciple of Francis Galton, okay, and Francis Galton was the first cousin of Charles Darwin, okay. So Galton was doing a lot of work in the area of heredity, and he was trying to find out some relationship. He didn't get what he wanted, but he was he was very famous as such because of many other things that he did. Now, a hardcore statistician, and he never believed the word causation. Okay, he said data is all that is needed. So he was a hardcore data person, nothing else. He never believed that there can be a causation, which he did say that it does. He was basically saying that causation is a special case of correlation. That was his way of thinking. But the challenge is that these people, they try to find out reasoning or ways to say that causation is not important because it cannot be defined. That was their reasoning, that it's something which we cannot sort of find out, so therefore it is not important. In fact, you know, you will find papers where people have said that the topic of causation is not a scientific topic. It is unscience, okay, and it has been there since ages. It is just the last 30-40 years when with the help of computer scientists, epidemiologists, you know, sociologists, this topic has come back, and with the new area of machine learning progressing very rapidly, this has again come back to the fore. So, the challenge is that when you talk about only two variables, it is still an easy problem. When you talk about multiple variables, it becomes extremely challenging. So, is there a way for us to establish causation? Is there a way for us to find out? Okay. So, one very famous scientist by the name of Sewall Wright, okay, he, after graduating from Harvard, joined a university as a professor. If I am not wrong, it was University of Chicago, and he was actually working on guinea pigs, okay, before he joined Chicago. Okay. So, he wrote a paper in 1925, which actually used some very technical stuff like path diagrams and, you know, many other things through which he tried to explain the concept of causation. So, he was quite against Pearson. He was just the opposite of what Pearson used to say. So, Sewall Wright was phenomenal in bringing in front of the world the deeper concepts of causation. Now, the path diagrams and the in the path analysis that Sewall Wright proposed has found resonance with many people even after that. And one of the things which actually came after you know, some bit of work there was what we call as RCT, and it is not RCT of the tooth, it is called as randomized controlled trial. Okay. So, they said that there is a possibility for us to find out or observe specific things. So, what we are saying is that, you know, the existing data may not be able to answer the question of cause effect, but we can do experiments. Okay. We can do other experiments which would help us in getting this answer. Okay. So, one of the important experimental design is called as randomized control trial. It is basically a gold standard in the field of medicine, in the field of epidemiology, and a lot of people use it, you know, in the business context, sociology, psychology, everywhere you would find the usage of this term randomized control trial. Okay. Let me take you to a history here. So, there was you know, in 597 BC, the king of Babylon captured you know, the many of the areas nearby, and he brought back those captives into his kingdom. Now, he told one person by the name of Ashpenaz that can you identify some children who are from noble families from the captive areas and who have intelligence, can we groom them for our court? That was his case. So they identified. Ashpenaz went into the town, found out all the children who are young, who are intelligent, who can be trained to be part of the court of the king. Okay. So, one child by the name of Daniel, and you can search this history, it is very interesting. By the name of Daniel, he refused to eat the food given by Ashpenaz. So, Ashpenaz was basically giving these children some special food. Those were called as king's meat and royal wine and so on, so that they develop into you know, a better people as per their requirement. Okay. Daniel said that, you know, anything which is not prepared as per the Israeli customs or the Jewish customs, I cannot eat. Ashpenaz was worried that if the king is able to find out this fact, then Ashpenaz will be executed. Okay. So, he has to feed everyone, all those identified children, royal meat and you know, royal wine for them to develop as a personality which can serve in the court of the king. Now, so Daniel you know, told Ashpenaz that why don't you do an experiment? Why don't you take four of us and gives us vegetarian diet and rest of the people give them the non-veg diet or the king's diet and observe for 10 days. So, unwillingly Ashwin has agreed, and these four people or children were given the veg diet, and the rest of them were given the king's diet as proposed. At the end of 10 days, what was observed was that you know, they grew equally well along with other children. So, the hypothesis here was, or the question here was, that you know, is veg diet going to make the children weak? That was a question, right? And so that was a why question, right? I mean, basically we are asking a question, is it going to make them weak, and then why? Okay. So, so to answer that question, Daniel basically proposed an experiment, and Daniel's experiment was quite modern in all aspect, considering the time in which it was proposed. But let me add that there is a, or do you find any problem in this experiment? Let me ask this question to you. Do you find any problem with this experiment? You know, four people identified as one group, the rest of the people another group, they were given two different meals, and at the end of 10 days we observed the final output, which we do all the time, right? We do this in business, in if you see Netflix or even in other many other website, there is a concept called A-B testing. Some of you might be aware. In A-B testing, what we do is each person gets to see a different version of Netflix. Okay, and through experiment they find out which one is better. So, if they have many versions of this and they want to test, there is something called as A-B testing, A/B testing. So basically, do you find any problem with this method of experimentation? Okay, that's a good point. Very good. Sample size was small and number of days were small for you to have any good observation. What else? Yes, very good. So, this point is very, very important. Anybody else? Yes. So, you know, there is this term called as confounding bias, okay, or let me call it as confounders, okay, right now forget the term bias, okay. So, confounders is a term. So, let me give this example, that what if Daniel and his friends were already more healthy than the rest of the group, okay, and Daniel knew it. So, which means at the end of 10 days, okay, the fact that they grew equally well along with the other children may not have anything to do with the veg diet that they ate. How would I say at the end of 10 days, because of this veg diet, they actually were well? So, it is quite possible that there can be a confounding bias in this scenario, right? The other thing is that the number of people who are in this experiment was small. There is also a possibility that you know, that only a certain people were in the Daniel's group and the other type of people were in the other group, which I already talked about, and there can be many other such factors which are controlling variables, confounding variables, and so on. So, basically did these factors were taken into consideration in that experiment? The answer is no, but in today's time we do take care of such scenarios when we talk about randomization. Or in fact, we assume that randomization automatically takes care of many of such problems, right? So, let us look at this example. I will leave it on the screen for some time for you to read, and then I will explain this to you. Okay. So, those of you who have heard some names, let me also throw another name. I am throwing lots of names here. There is a famous person by the name of R. A. Fisher, and in fact R. A. Fisher recommended RCT or randomized controlled trials, and as I said, it's already considered a gold standard in the field of medicine, epidemiology, and it's used extensively everywhere. Now, in 1998, Robert Abbott published a paper in New England Journal of Medicine, and it basically it did something. It did an experiment with 707 men who were chosen from a large cohort of 8,000 people. Okay, and it was observed for a long time. So the time factor is now considered. So if you is there, yes. So they were observed for a period of 12 years. So 707 people, and you can understand how difficult are these experiments, right? So we selected 707 people and then asked them to walk 1 mile and 2 miles randomly. Okay, and you know, we observed outcome for 12 years, and in the end we said that the conclusion is about STIM find out, that the death rate over a 12 year period was 2 times higher among men who walked less than 1 mile a day than among men who walked 2 miles a day. So 43% of casual, okay, it is not causal, 43% of casual walkers had died, while only 21.5% of intense walkers had died. Now, so this was interesting. Now the question is, what are the conclusions from this experiment? So can you tell me some conclusions that you can draw from this experiment? It was a randomized experiment done for over a period of 12 years. What are the possible things that you can add here if you want to add? Yes. Okay, age. Okay, the more you walk, the more you live longer.
What is the upper limit?
So, but that's what he is basically saying, that you know, the more you walk, the more you will live. That's what he is trying to establish.
How old was the 707?
Okay, so let's look at this. Oh, age is one factor. Any other factor? Okay, so so basically, as I said in the previous example, that there can be confounders, and Abbott was a biostatistician, and he knew some of these factors because. As you can see, it happened in 1998 when these fields were fairly mature. So he did take into consideration the age factor, which is a confounding bias, right? I mean, why age is a confounder? Because younger people tend to walk more, and they also have more lifespan left. So it doesn't necessarily say that walking has caused them to die later, right? So age is a confounder, and thankfully they did consider that. Any other thing?
Biological background.
I can say previous health conditions, right? So I can say previous health conditions, that if my previous, and you can't see everything from outside, that's a challenge, right? I can ask people, first of all, getting people to participate in experiment itself is a difficult task, right? Then I have to get data of their health condition. I can get all that checked, but even if you check, you will not be able to know all the conditions. So it's quite possible that those who walked more were healthier compared to those who walked less, right? Anything else as a confounder? There can be many other lurking variables, like let's say people who walked less were drinkers. So because they were also drinkers, they tend to be sloppy in the morning, and they were, you know, walking less, and but the less walking didn't cause them to die early. It was the drinking habit which was probably causing them to die early, right? So the conclusion in that sense may not stand the test of the time. Thankfully, the Abbott team did consider many of these factors, and I mean all factors that they could think, they did adjust, and in this randomized control trial they took all those factors and did adjustments with respect to many of these confounding biases. Okay, in sometimes in fact many people do over adjustments. Okay, and they are very careful in also using the what we call as the conclusion. They are very circumspect in their conclusion. If you go back to the paper and read it, find the look at the conclusive section, you would see that they were not very I would say confident when they said that, you know, walking more walking leads to you know death later is something that didn't exactly say. Okay. So, they were very careful. I want to tell you that in the causal reasoning, while randomized controlled trial is a very beautiful concept and used today heavily, it is important for us to state the assumptions. So, just because you have randomized does not mean that all the assumptions are automatically taken care of, right? This is what we assume. You know, when we give online test, we feel that let's randomize the question, right? And so every question gets the same question in a different order, right? And it will take care of, let's say, the cheating case. Right? It's an assumption, right? And I need to state many of these assumptions in an inference engine for it to actually give me the right answer of questions which are basically why questions. Okay. Okay. So, one of the very interesting debate which I want to sort of highlight is the smoking cancer debate, and I will tell you why it is important. So, why you know, RCT was a gold standard, is a gold standard, is actually good for establishing causation, but there are many scenarios where you will not be able to use RCT. Example, if I want to establish that smoking causes cancer, can I do a randomized controlled trial? I will take, let us say, 500 young children of age 20 and I say smoke for 12 years because I am doing an experiment, and then I will see what happens. Okay, so, I will take 200 people who I say smoke for 12 years. The next 200 don't smoke for 12 years, and then my experiment I'll conclude at the end of 12 years. Is it ethical? Is it possible? Right. So there are many such scenarios where randomized controlled trial may not be possible, and this is one example. And there are many things like this. Right. So some people say that okay, if you are underweight and expecting or pregnant, there may be you know, some birth defect. How will I do this using randomized controlled trial? So, in many cases, randomized controlled trial may not be possible, may not be ethical, and so on. Now, the interesting thing is, in 1902, the share of tobacco, or rather the share of cigarette in the tobacco market in US was 2%, 2%. Okay. In 1952, the share of cigarette in the tobacco market was 81%. Just imagine the growth. Okay. And if you have seen any old movie, old serial, you would realize that, you know, the smoking was such a public health menace at that time, you know, that many of these committees were formed, researches were being done, and so on. Now, in 1952, when the whole country was basically smoking, this debate actually erupted, okay, in US, in Europe, in many of these countries. And it was now me versus them. It became a big fight between two set of people, one backed by these tobacco companies and one backed by these NGOs who were basically conscious of the health of people. Okay. And it turned out a very scientific debate. And the good part was that there were many scientists who were saying that no, smoking doesn't necessarily cause cancer, and many of them were themselves smokers. Okay. Even the fact that doctors, you know, at that time were also not accepting. They were not saying there is no correlation. In fact, it was very hard to miss the correlation between the smoking and the growth of lung cancer. In fact, in 1902, you know, the lung cancer prevalence was so low that a doctor probably will get one patient in his lifetime. That was the scenario, and it became so much. Now, all those people who are skeptics, all those people who are smokers and were intelligent, okay, they used to say, how do you say that smoking is causing cancer? You know, between this period of 50 years, okay, heavy industrialization has happened. Okay. Motor vehicles have come. There is much more vehicles on the road that we see. Because of that, there is tarring of road. So, all that could have caused, you know, so cancer to grow. So how do you isolate this as a factor? And they knew that RCT is not possible in this case. So they were coming up with one or the other excuse. In fact, there was a very famous professor from Berkeley, Yerushalmi, who never accepted that smoking causes cancer, and he was himself a heavy smoker. It became a personal issue for him. He kept writing. Any paper which used to come, he will say, this factor has not been accepted, not been considered in this research, therefore rejected. And at the other end, tobacco companies were supporting these people. They were funding them through other means. So it became a heavy debate. And you can see that there is a paper, 1954 paper, and look at the language. Look at the language very carefully. It says, we are of the opinion. Now it is, the word opinion says something to you, right? We are of the opinion that the association found between regular cigarette smoking, regular was not defined, okay, it can be a pack a day, two packs a day, three packs a day, or one a day, okay, regular smoking and death rates from disease of the coronary arteries, and between regular cigarette smoking and the death rate from lung cancer, reflect cause and effect relationship. They were still circumspect. In fact, the president at that time of US had to really intervene, and there were forced statements from many of the influential people to say that, lung cancer is caused heavily due to smoking. So, it did come down after that. So, if you see the impact of some of these heavy research which happened from 1960s onward, cigarette smoking to some extent started decreasing in US, although the market has overall increased. So, you still find a lot of people smoking, and all those people will give you the same reasoning that, my friend has smoked for the whole life and he never got lung cancer. So they are not discounting the fact that there is a relationship between smoking and cancer. They are, the problem with these people, the skeptics, is the word cause. Okay. They are saying you cannot necessarily deduce in a scientific manner that smoking causes cancer. That's all. And they bring in all other attributes, all other factors for their benefit. So, as I said, there is no one-to-one relationship. So take example of cholera. Okay. In cholera, there is a one-to-one relationship. If you have that what is called as bacillus bacteria, you will get cholera. If it is not there, you will not have. It's a one-to-one relation between the cause and effect, right? Or something like a vitamin C and scurvy. Okay. But in this case, you can do, and people did some of these studies in this scenario, because RCT was not possible. So they did observational studies in hospital setting as well as outside, and tried to conclude. So there are these researches which have been done in the way that you are talking about, okay, but none of them can conclusively actually prove, because you can always say that these two people are different, right? Every individual is different. So at the end of it, attribution that this group died because of only this reason is a slightly difficult problem. That's all. So people have done something like this many times in research.
Same with RCT, 100 people randomly selected non-smoker, 100 people randomly selected smoker.
Okay, so this is good. So what you are saying is a backward thing. Okay, I look at 10 people who are smokers, I look at 10 people who are not smokers, and then trace it back. Right? So I am saying I have the set of people who are smokers, I have the set of people who are non-smokers, let me go back in history and see what they are smoking since last 12 years, were they smoking 12 in a day, and so on, and then I will find out. So it's backward reasoning in that sense, right? Okay, so Yerushalmi, Fisher, they are all pro-smoking, and then, and of course, the tobacco companies were pro-smoking, and the rest of the people were anti-smoking, and finally, you can see that this is an official meeting, by the way, which is going on, and you can see all people in a particular way getting the final outcome of this paper, right? So now I'll come back to this question. I'll ask you to define causality. So we have done some bit of work. Now let's look at this question. What is causality. Can somebody try and answer this question? So, the philosophers from Socrates to Aristotle to Russell to I do not know all, I mean you know many of the philosophers have actually tried to define this term. So, it is a topic of philosophy, okay, went into sociology, physics, lot of physicists were also philosophers, and the good part of physics is that they added probability in this definition. So, computer scientists, everybody tried to define this term causality, but we could not find one universal definition which is true in all cases. In fact, David Hume came very close to the correctness of this, but still was far, I mean people always disputed the definition. So, the you know I read couple of books on this topic, and in most of the books I could not find a definition which the author has given. The definitions were all given by A philosopher, B philosopher, C philosopher, A, B, C, but the author himself did not dare to define. Okay. So, this question is an open question for all of you, and if you would like to answer right now, feel free to give me some answers. Yes. Okay, so if you do this, then the effect is this. If I light a match box, then fire will happen, right? If I light a match box, then fire will happen. If I do not light a match box, fire will not happen, right? Fire can happen because of many other reasons. And intervention and let us say confounders. For the fire to happen, you need oxygen. I can light the matchbox, there is no oxygen in the room, there will be no fire. So, just by you know using the matchbox, I still will not get the fire if there is no oxygen in the room. Anybody else? And this is exactly what used to happen. People used to define and somebody else will come and refute that, saying this situation, this definition is not fitting. Okay, so anybody else would like to try? Just try. This is not an exam. Okay, so that's a good thing. The relation between two phenomena, it is correlation, it is association, right? Okay. Okay.
Or
so that's one. So we say that the cause have to precede the effect, okay, it is temporal, right? The cause has to happen before the effect comes into play, okay. So, that is one. It is asymmetric. A will cause B, but B will not cause A. It is like you know a rooster crow and the sun coming in the morning is heavily correlated, right? Rooster's crow and the sun comes in the morning every day, but one day the rooster decides I will not, right? It is unidirectional. Yes. So, in fact, this is one of the problems that we see in this area. Oh, there is no marker. You know, in mathematics we say A is equal to x into y, and then you can change that equation in any way. You will say A is equal to x into y, x is equal to a by y and so on. You can just turn around the equation anyway. If you have two, you will get the third one, but in this case it does not work like that, right? It does not work like that, right? Okay. All right. So, I'll leave this for you to do as a homework. Go ahead and read, and as I said, you will find books and books which just try to define this term, okay? All right. So, here is an interesting question for students. Look at this conversation. It does not matter for me, I am married already. Is it possible? is it possible? Okay, let me take this example. Let's take a example. I have taken a numerical example. Okay, now see, there are basically 400 people, 150 male, 250 female. This is the response, right? They recommend. So TGKIF is basically the Great Kebab Factory, one of my favorite restaurants. Okay, so this is the data. Now look at the data. Do you find some problem? Okay, this, let me give you this example. Now imagine a doctor, let's call him as Dr. Simpson, okay, and he is exploring a new drug. Okay, there's a doctor, let me call him as Simpson, he is exploring a drug, okay, and the drug that seems to reduce the risk of heart attack. He goes and looks at the data that he has collected, and he looks at the data of all males, okay. And what he observes in the data is actually drug D is bad for males. That means when you give the drug, it actually increases the chance of heart attack. Okay, that was his observation. So he is unhappy about this. He thought, okay, maybe this drug is better for women. He goes and takes a look at the data of women, and what he observes is that this drug actually is bad for women as well, but overall the drug is good for people. Overall the drug is good for people. In fact, you know, this is a very interesting problem. Okay, it is called a Simpson's paradox. There are PhD thesis on this. There are PhD thesis on this. In fact, one of the PhD student at that time in 1983 probably, his name was Melvin. He said, he wrote in fact, that when the gender of the patient is male, don't use the drug. The gender of the patient is female, don't use the drug. If the gender is unknown, use the drug. So if I ask, is my class good for people? Yes. But if I look at the data, it says it's bad for girls, bad for boys. It is intriguing problem. Okay, can you say, tell me why it is happening? So this is a reality, right? You understand from the data. I have just shown you this data. It is actual data. I mean, it's a fictitious data, but you can see the calculation. Okay, this can happen, and in real world scenario, it has happened. It has baffled scientists for many years that I know. So can you explain to me, first of all, do you believe what is happening? Okay, so it's quite a possibility. Now tell me, what is the reason? This conclusion is ridiculous, no doubt about it, but it is happening. What is the reason in this case?
Scale effect.
Scale effect, okay. The number of people, not same for a particular side, all right. Not necessarily. Okay, so you've come to this point that many times aggregation of data will just reverse the conclusion. It is a wrong thing. It's not always right that I collect data from this, I collect data from this, and merge the two. That aggregation, yes, but people do it all the time. People do it all the time in research.
Exit polls
are classic examples, right? These all things are done, and a normal public is fooled. Statistics is a very good tool to fool people, right? So it is something which is a reality. It has happened, and I will tell you that, you know, it can be resolved if you consider these confounding variables. If you consider this causal reasoning and use a causal inference engine to get answer of some of these questions, you would be able to resolve some of these problems. And there are famous interesting paradoxes which still is elusive for many of the people. Okay, so So we don't have much time. I will quickly you know, summarize what I said. So if you look at the relationship, right, we have definitely made tremendous progress in the area of artificial intelligence, and this concept of deep learning is extremely popular in today's parlance, right? And it is, what deep learning tries to do is to fit a function, right? You know, in normal regression you used to fit a line and all, you are basically trying to fit a function. Okay, now if you are trying to fit a function, what defines that function? Ultimately data. So data is what is defining what function I will choose. Okay, so and then you have added many layers of convolution between them, and we keep adding those layers and, you know, making it more better in terms of output. Today we are basically saying it's not just deep learning but deep understanding which is important. And you understand the difference between learning and understanding, right? Learning is about facts. Understanding is much more than the facts, right? So this field doesn't only need mathematicians. It needs mathematicians, it needs statisticians, which is part of the mathematics group, it needs computer scientists, it needs, you know, sociologists, it needs, you know, it needs everybody. It is a truly interdisciplinary field which needs, you need to know the process which has been used to gather the data. You need to know many of the context around that data, not just data. That's why I said data is dumb. Data is not reality. Data is a window to the reality. Okay, and you need some other support to see the real thing. So data itself will not answer many of these important questions. We have to go build a layer over it, which is your analysis, analytics, and which will need many other information beyond what is available in the crude data. So data is useful, but it has a limited usefulness. You need to build something over above so that you can make full use of it. Okay. Now, other thing, come here, deep learning is the antithesis of transparency, and I'll tell you why. You must have seen so long time back, this DeepMind, which is a subsidiary of IBM, was able to defeat Garry Kasparov in the game of chess, right? And it became a big phenomena. It was basically a win of machine over human beings, because chess was used to consider, used to be considered as an epitome of human intelligence, right? And DeepMind was able to take care of it. A huge set of data, huge time and huge money was invested in training DeepMind to do what it did. There is a very complex, much more complex than chess, AlphaGo. Have you heard about it? This Go game. So AlphaGo was also programmed, and it was able to take care of success the way DeepMind did it. It was still a lot of rules that they were able to learn and use them effectively to defeat human beings. But if you ask the DeepMind engineer why and how this machine was able to defeat Garry Kasparov, they will not be able to answer this question. So they know that given this input, this is the output, but if you ask them what has happened in between, that's all hidden in those hidden neural networks. And I, as a scientist or the engineer who has defined that software, I will not be able to explain. Okay, it acts as a black box. Give the input, it will give the output, and I keep rotating back the feedback and I keep improving the machine to give the output. But at the end of the day, I will not be able to explain why it is doing what it is doing. And therefore, a new field of AI has taken birth, which is called as explainable AI, which is basically saying I will tell you reasons of why the AI is saying. Just assume that you are denied a loan because the AI program is saying you are not worth a loan. You will go to the manager and say, why I was denied the loan, and that answer has to be given. But the manager will say, I don't know, the machine has given me this answer, right? And you go back to the engineer of the software, he will say, I also don't know, I trained the machine to do this, now I don't know what it is doing inside, right? So it's a very difficult thing. So explainable AI is also at a nascent stage, and I think we are now going to move towards the transparency in the field of AI, which is going to be extremely important going forward. Okay, so we talk about, you know, so as I, let me go back to what I said in the beginning, Alan Turing, right? Alan Turing in 1950 wrote this paper, Computing Machinery and Intelligence. And, you know, that defined the field of AI for a long, long time. When we talk about strong AI, okay, so the current AI is very statistical basically, okay. When you talk about strong AI, we are saying the machine will have consciousness. The machine will have regret. How do I regret? Why do I regret? Because I feel I should have acted differently. So I should be able to put that kind of knowledge in the machine that it regrets, which means it is able to find out a counterfactual world, imaginary world, where it had acted differently, it would have been better. Something like a self-driving car that we are talking about. So strong AI, this causal model is now not a luxury, okay. It is a necessity if we want to grow to this strong AI. There are new programming languages, you know, which are called as probabilistic programming languages. You know, the reinforcement learning is a move in the right direction, but you know, there is a field called causal reinforcement learning, and all those perhaps in some time from now will lead us to the field of strong AI, where the AI will have consciousness, feeling, many other attributes that defines human beings. Okay. So basically, in the end, I would like to ask some of the questions you know, to you, right? What are those questions? First question, let me say, have we already built machines which can think? What is the answer? Have we already built machines which can think? No. Okay. Can we make machines that can think? Okay. Let me ask the third question. Will we make machines that think? Okay. Fourth question. Should we make machines that think? Right. So we need to answer all these questions, and I really got interested in the field of causality because of some work of this person. Okay, so I wanted to thank him for many of the articles that he has written on causality. In fact, you know, causality as a field in computer science has developed because of primarily him. He is a Turing Award winner and you know, computer scientist, and has done tremendous contribution in the field of causality. So with this, I will I'll say thanks. I'll end the talk. I'll be open to questions. Thank you. Yes.
My question is, once you gather data, so there is huge scope to play with data, and you can bring any picture out of it.
Yes.
So how to sort out this?
That is why you need to write the assumptions. I told you in one of the slides that assumption, don't try to hide the assumptions. Whenever I look at the conclusion without knowing what were the assumptions made in making those conclusions, more likely that the conclusions were not right. Yes. And look at the engine, they require this set of assumptions as part of the input. Okay. Yes. So I assume that I'll have an audience from all fields, and therefore I kept the talk generic so that I don't go too much into detail, yet I don't lose the importance of the technical stuff, which is important for you to at least get a hang of it.
So answer the four questions for us.
Yes. So you know, this is not an easy answer to give. A difficult question is, should we make the machines that think? And you know, it's an answer which the entire world has to give together. These are global questions. It's not a question for one individual. Okay. The time, you know, whenever the time of a technology comes, it's a famous saying that no technology can be stopped if its time has come.
Right.
Yes.
Is being recreated.
Yes.
DNA sequencing.
DNA sequencing. Absolutely. Absolutely. In fact, biotechnology and science has changed many things in the last many years, and a lot will be changed because now we are getting inside the mind and the body of human being and try to, you know, so neuroscience, you know, epidemiology, biology, life scientists, computer scientists, they're all coming together and trying to influence us in very different way that is very hard to imagine today. Right? Very, very nascent. As of now, you know, it is very nascent. It can't, it has some bits and pieces which you can explain, but you can't necessarily explain everything inside the black box. Okay. So, very nascent. All right. So, if there are no more questions, we'll end the talk. Thank you so much for your attention. Thank you.